Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Welcome, and my name is Lynn Ritchie, and it's my pleasure to be here worshiping with you this morning. A warm welcome is extended to everybody who is worshiping virtually from near and far, and it's wonderful to see everybody in person here today, too. So thank you so much for joining us, and your presence is a blessing. I hope you had the opportunity to see some of the announcements on the screen. I'd like to bring your attention to a couple of them today, and the first is that May is Manse Month, and we won't be having a Mission of the Month this month, but if you could prayerfully consider making a contribution to the Manse account, that would be very much appreciated. I know they're working on doing some repairs and maintenance for the Manse, so that would be wonderful. And the other is, I don't know if you had the opportunity coming in to see these baby bottles, but it's called Formula for Success. And all donations, you can put them inside the baby bottle, any coin or cash. They're also taking online donations as well as checks, and you will get a tax receipt. So it's to help with the Pregnancy Care and Family Support Center. So that would be very much appreciated as well. So if you could join with me now to say the opening prayer.
Oh, good morning, everybody. I got moved over. Camera got banged around or something. We'll get Craig to shift me back. So, yeah, good morning, everybody. We've had some technical difficulties already this morning, and we had to restart everything in order to get that camera to work over there on the lectern so we could see Lynn's lovely smiling face, and I'm glad to see her. So welcome. Greetings. Hopefully they were able to stick with us. I'm still here in Sudbury, says Eunice Pierce. Lisa says, hello again. Jan says, we are here in Halliburton at the service. How did you do that, Jan? She's over there, and she's over. How do you do that? Jan Tedford said she lost Lynn's sound. Oh, no. Do we have my sound? I got mine turned on. Jen, good morning. Finally got all plants. God, no more snow. Please, God, no more snow. Because they put the plants in. That's Jen Burke. So is the sound thing showing up? Greg, okay. So I don't know what that was. I think we're okay. 26 in-house. We're just packed full of guests today. Welcome all you who are guests in the church today. Bravely come to our service. Now, what else is going on? I'm a little bit, that puts me in a little bit of a, what is the word? Flutter? Yeah, so I have to calm a little bit here. That kind of thing does happen, and we don't know why, really. It's a glitch, and so sometimes we just have to restart stuff to get it going. Which reminds me that a week ago Friday, the internet went off here at Halliburton United for 2 or 3 hours, and over a big chunk of town. Oh. So our provider, North Frontenac, they had some kind of problem, and a whole lot of people were out, and that can happen. So if that happens on a Sunday and you're watching and you can't get it, it's always going to be recorded, and we will post it later one way or another. So
so Harry and I belong to a Facebook group called Canadian United Churches live stream or something like that. And they taught somebody 2 weeks ago lost all their hydro about 5 minutes into the service. And they couldn't stream. They couldn't do the service. They couldn't, had no sound for the service in house. They had nothing.
So that can happen. And, you know, that's why it's better to come right to the church if you can. And we shall carry on no matter what. We have a real piano. What else? I guess that's... So yesterday was the isolated men's breakfast. And I do have a few pictures, hopefully, from that, that I can show you of the gentlemen who were involved yesterday. So stick me on... Okay, so you probably recognize that as the gentleman John Peel, who may just be coming in the door right now.
I don't know how many of these guys make their own breakfast.
Oh, John, you're there. Cleverly disguised with a mask on. John and Barb are here. And he has a hearty breakfast, I got to say. A hearty breakfast. So then Len Logazar over in Collingwood. Now, he does not have as hearty a breakfast. He didn't want to have a heart attack before he hit the golf course yesterday morning. Yep, in the hot blazing sun. Now, there's me. I've got a little bit of backlight, but you notice I had some struggles with somebody. I had an egg, so it may look pathetic because it's just one egg, but there you are. And my cereal, and my dog tried to get the egg, so. But you see, there's some interesting things. Notice the beautiful flowers that I have. Yes, those are Mother's Day flowers left over from last week from here. Yeah, carnations. And I was reading the Bible. Cousin Jim Roberts with his candlelit breakfast. He's got a lot of style, that guy. And I left these guys to the last because they really weren't having breakfast. So the Currys and the Benoits were out hobnobbing on Friday night.
Beer for breakfast.
Yesterday at lunch. Oh, okay. It looks like a lovely breakfast. But, you know, all the rules have been broken because there's definitely girls at this breakfast. I don't know. Hamburgers and fries. And?
There you go.
So it's kind of like burger, beer, and Bible, you know. Okay. I think that was the works, then, right? Yeah, background jump. Oh, yeah, the eye guys. The eye guys. Two optometrists. Okay. Melissa has a special piece of music for us to calm down and meditate to.
That's and requested by
Harry. Oh, wow, really?
Yeah.
Okay, let Craig get started here.
Good old internet. Thank you. go on for days.
Okay, good. Thanks, Melissa. That was in case you didn't know, a tune called The Holy City. And those were scenes of Jerusalem and environs and churches there. And there's method to that madness, which we shall see in a moment. So we're into the book of Revelation today. All who are, and there's a lot of talk in there about the river that flows by the throne of God. We're going to sing about that at the last end of the service. So we're going to sing All Who Are Thirsty. And I got to strap this guitar on. Change mics. This is a relatively new piece by Brenton Brown. Benton's a local guy.
It says Benton.
Brenton.
It's not what it says here.
What's his name?
It's another Benton Brown.
I don't think so. It's not really sounding great, but. Okay, you start.
All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the streams of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. All who are thirsty, and all who are weak, won't you come to the fountain? Dip your heart in the streams of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy, as deep cries out. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Holy Spirit.
Turn my mic on. Thank you. 23 concurrent devices. Good morning from Doug and Ruth Mitchell and Eunice Pierce. Shut off fans, closed doors, restarted my iPad. Thought I wasn't going to catch up. Eunice, that's Cheryl's mom up in Sudbury. And Peggy says, we can hear you. So sound is working. That's good. Okay. Let's continue to worship the Lord as we present our offerings. And since Warren and Jean Curry came all the way from Hamilton, we're gonna get them to take it up. Warren. Good to see you, man. Jean? Oh, people are laughing at the offering. Let's sing.
We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee.
Okay, it's time for prayers. Couple of additions. I guess it was actually Len Logazar alerted us to it, but Ben, you knew. Chris Bishop, the older Chris Bishop, there's two. This is Chris Bishop of Sir Sam's. He's got non-Hodgkin's lymphoma of the liver.
Is this Nancy's husband?
Yes, married to Nancy. So we'll be praying for Chris. And you may or may not have heard Lisa Frost passed away a couple days ago. So this is Bill Frost's wife and Marilyn and Jim's daughter-in-law. So she had a tumor. I guess it was, inoperable brain tumor from the fall. And aggressive, yes. So that was just a couple days ago. I think it was Friday. So family of Lisa Frost. I don't know if any of you know, I have a service on Wednesday for Frida Williamson. She was a resident of the eastern side of the county, but ended up at Highland Crest. She was 98 and a World War II vet, Air Force vet. Yeah, Diane. Oh, okay. Right. Find that. Family of, Carol Purnell. Family of Gary. So, somebody was reminding me they can't hear you guys. So, family of Gary Purnell. We've been praying for Carol Purnell on our prayer list. So, this is her husband. He passed away. Debbie. Oh, good. Yeah. Way up. Doing better. So Ron Bain's been struggling with some high blood pressure, but they've got it under control. I'm telling these people. Yeah. So we'll keep praying for Ron for now. Ted Schultz is on our list. He's having, if he got his COVID test done in time, which is a big if, he's supposed to have surgery tomorrow for colon cancer. So they're taking a piece out of his colon. You guys know Ted Schultz?
Yeah.
Kind of invented the thrift warehouse, which I used to call Ted's Emporium, but I guess Kim. Still do. Yeah, there you go. That's it.
Sorry, I'm playing for the music for the last time.
Oh, it's 7:10 in the Fifth Voices United.
It says hymns for the family of God.
Oh, I missed that. Sorry.
Hymns for the family of God doesn't go to something.
No. So, okay. Sorry.
It's okay.
Miss Prince.
Family of God.
Okay, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of prayer to calms our hearts and brings peace, Lord, because we can cast all our cares upon you because you care for us and you commanded us and taught us to pray. Lord, so we hold you to your many promises that if we ask, we shall receive, if we seek, we shall find, if we knock, the door will be opened to us. So, Lord, we lift our concerns and needs, great needs, to you today. We think of still Ukraine and the war there. We pray for an end to it, an end to hostility, that you would save and protect lives and health. You would comfort the bereaved, Lord, and you would simply bring your peace. Lord, we lift them to you. We pray for ourselves and our world as we continue to struggle with COVID-19 worldwide, and many places of the world are struggling to get vaccine. We pray that would happen. And Lord, we lift ourselves to you, that you would protect the vulnerable and watch over those who have put themselves at risk to provide health care for others, Lord. And we thank you for all the measures that we have been given to protect ourselves, Lord. And we pray for an end to this and return to normalcy. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. And we lift each one on our list to you today, Lord. We pray that you would meet their needs and the needs of their families and those that love them and surround them, that you would bring comfort, that you would bring healing, that you would bring recovery, Lord, all that is needed. So we remember them to you. We think of Chris Bishop and Ted Schultz, Alex Buxey, Jessica, Ron Bain, the Gardens of Halliburton, the COVID outbreak there, Deborah Waterhouse, Cliff Smith, Corey, and Dawn. Lord, hear our prayer. In your love, answer. We pray for Scott, for Isabel Jolly, Bernice Ross, Linda Richardson, Walt Griffin Jr., Murray Misko, Victoria Ancaster, the family of Lisa Frost, Rolly Faubert, Olive and Jim Waugh, Paul, Bernie, and Linda Harper. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. We pray for Mary Sechrist and Gary Swaggerman, Kelsey Barnum, John Payne, Judy Davis, Ron Mark Jr., Mark Beach and Teresa, Carol Parnell and all her family in the loss of Gary Parnell, Kathy Binns, Amy Blanchard. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. And we pray for Allie and Courtney, Caroline Hunter, Maureen Duquette, Chris Rusk, John Bond, Don and Karen Tran, Darko Knezovich, Steve Wiggin, and others that we remember now before you in the quiet of our hearts. Lord, hear our prayer, and in your love, answer. For we pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus, our living Savior. Amen. I'm just talking to Jackie before the service, and she's talked to Judy Nyman, who Rolly Faubert is her partner. And Rolly was diagnosed with cancer of the lung, I guess, but he was not supposed to last past the end of March, so he's still going. He's down in the Cornwall area and enjoying time with his family. So it's the middle of May now. He's just weakened, but still without pain. So they live they have a place right here, like next door to the church.
And a place on Dragway.
And a place on Dragway, yeah. And the other thing was Mark and Teresa Beach, we've been praying for. Mark was taken down by COVID well over a year. It's like a year and a half now. And he's just barely slowly getting some rehabilitation, and he's got a wheelchair, and he's got a van. They gave him a van, a wheelchair van, somebody did. So he can, gives somebody like that a lot of hope. So that's pretty cool. So that was good news. I think that's it for this. We'll call upon Lynn Ritchie to come on back and to lead us in our prayer and read our scripture.
Please join me now with the prayer of illumination. Gracious God, give us humble, teachable, and obedient hearts
that we may receive what you have revealed and do what you have commanded, through Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Now our scripture reading this morning is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 to 6 in the NIV version. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life." May God bless this reading of his word.
Thanks, Lynn. Well, we're not quite there yet, but we're going to sing "Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken," which is Zion, city of our God. We're talking about Zion, which is an alternate word for Jerusalem. And I believe that this hymn refers much to the vision we've just seen of the new Jerusalem. Okay.
"Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God. He whose word cannot be broken, born thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded, what can shake thy sure repose? With salvation's walls surrounded, thou mayst smile at all thy foes. See the streams of living
Let's pray. Lord, as we consider your word, we seek your help, your assistance, your grace to open our eyes to see, our hearts to understand what you have in store for us, Lord, and what you have promised us, Lord, that our faith might grow and our love for you might grow and our obedience to you might grow. So, Lord, we lift ourselves to you and pour your spirit upon us, Lord, in this time. We ask it in your name, Jesus our Lord. Amen. Digging into the book of Revelation. One always does that with fear and trembling. Not so, because it is difficult. I'll admit it's somewhat difficult. Also, a whole lot of people have different ideas about what it means. So you get yourself in no end of trouble with alternate interpretations. And I'll get there. So all things new. So basically, the start of the passage, which Lynn just read, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And then it goes on and on, and it says, behold, I am making everything new. All things are being made new. So to me, this is you know, it's the fifth Sunday in Easter. This is a very much an Easter theme. It's about the resurrection of Christ. So I keep seeking to correct my own thinking. We kind of grew up with, well, you know, if you're Christian or, you know, for whatever reason, afterlife, you go off to heaven someplace, whatever that is. It's kind of vague. And the Bible actually has a whole lot more to say about it, and it isn't so much going off to heaven somewhere as is God is going to create a new, recreate the universe. He's going to make a new heavens and a new earth, and the old will pass away. And the beginning of that is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I mean, it's predicted and talked about all through the Bible, even Old Testament, Hebrew scriptures. But when Jesus is resurrected from the dead, he is the first of this new heavens and the new earth. He is the beginning of that. He is actually the God has released the power for that to happen through raising Jesus from the dead. So Jesus is physical. He's corporeal, but he's different. He eats fish. You know, we read in Luke, he eats fish, and we read in John that he gets people to touch him. There's a physicality about him, and yet he can disappear in and out of the rooms, which is not what we can do yet. But it does say, and I say yet, deliberately, because it says he is the firstborn of those who have fallen asleep. And then it says, this is all 1 Corinthians 15, Paul describing the significance of the resurrection. He says, this perishable, which is what we are, must put on the imperishable. This mortal must put on immortality. Then will pass, come to pass the saying which is written, death is swallowed up in victory. So I got to remember to stand over here. I'm getting a little excited. It's such a wonderful topic. So you know, the new heavens and the new earth, which is not just talked about here. Peter talks about it, and I think it's 2 Peter. He says, you know, we expect a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. He's going to do, and again, that he will destroy the old. The old will pass away with fire. So this is the second last chapter of the Bible. 21. There's only 22 chapters in the book of Revelation. So, and I've pointed this out before, Revelation and Genesis are kind of bookends to the Bible. Good book. So at the beginning we have the creation of God, and at the end we have the new creation of God. So God's going to restore his creation, and it will be a physical thing. And all things new kind of idea reminds me of an oft-quoted verse, well, at least by myself, from 2 Corinthians. It's, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away, all things have become new. So according to the definition of Scripture, if you are in Christ, if you have become a believer in Jesus Christ, if you have become a child of God, God's Spirit dwells within you, but you've been recreated. But the old is still clinging on for the time being, but who you really are is you are a new creature, a new creation, and you're part of this, the new heavens and the new earth. And all things have become new, and the old has passed away, in some mystical sense, I suppose, but real. So it's hard for us to comprehend these things. So let's take a look at some of and there was no longer any sea. There's a head scratcher for you to go home and think about. Why would there be no sea? And I don't know. But I can guess, and I'm willing to guess. Well, things are in context, right? So not just a few chapters earlier in Revelation, it talks about both the beast and the false prophet coming out of the sea. So the sea in Revelation is kind of seen as the source of evil. It's metaphorically used as, you know, evil comes from that. So when he says there's not going to be any more sea, he's saying there's not going to be any more evil. Ah, maybe. So I could be right about everything I'm telling you today, but I could be wrong. And you could be right if you have an alternative interpretation, and I could well be wrong. But this is to get you thinking about it at any rate. So then he sees, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride. I saw the holy city. This is the new Jerusalem, Mount Zion, the city of the living God. There's a whole lot of synonyms for the place. And it's coming down from heaven, prepared as a bride dressed for her husband. So this is from this picture here. Here's my, I'm going to get my thing for the church people. I've got a laser pointer, which you can't see online. I wonder what I can do to the camera. I wonder what that did. So this is John, the author of Revelation, and this is an angel. So if you go through the book of Revelation, you'll notice that a lot of it is John is being accompanied by an angel as he takes him through these amazing visions that he sees. And he asks the angel questions, and the angel instructs him about things and so forth. So that's 1690, this idea of this passage. I think I'm losing my microphone again. There we go. Didn't mean to do that. There's another idea. So this is an artist's idea of the holy city coming down from heaven. You know, I've been thinking about this. What's the big deal about this city? So you got the new heavens and the new earth, but then in addition to that, the new holy city, the heavenly Jerusalem, comes down out of heaven and lands on the earth, right? That's the picture we're given. And most of us, especially that are here today, are kind of rural dwellers, and we're like, who wants to live in a city anyway? So I'm scratching my head a little bit, but you know, most of the world now does live in cities, and so it's interesting. So all the things that you hate about cities, if you could subtract those, you know, whether it's the commercialism and the traffic and the smog and the density of population and it's a place filled with beautiful people and parks and rivers flowing what is being presented to us here is an ideal community, because you and I are community dwellers. We need each other, and God's plan is to, you know, here's the first commandment: love the Lord your God. Second, love your neighbor as yourself, and form community. Learn how to get along. Learn how to serve one another. That's all, you know, all through the New Testament. So the holy city is this representation of the perfect city, the perfect dwelling of humans together without all the negative stuff. A few other artists' conceptions or ideas. This was, you'll notice that was in the last hymn as well. Did you pick up on that? Anyway, it's a little continuity there between the hymns. The city of gold. So a little further in the passage, it describes it as, the city was made of pure gold, clear as crystal. Okay, gold? That's really funny. Now was the city, here's where we get, how do you interpret this stuff? If you take it all literally, and you think that whole city is going to be entirely gold, I don't think I'm going to like it there. You know, it's just going to be too hard on my eyes. I don't think that's what it means. I think there's a literal meaning, but the picture is not meant to be taken literally. That's my view. And it's meant to be taken metaphorically. So pure gold just means the place is pure. It's a place of righteousness. It's a place of goodness. It's a place of perfection. Similar to, there it is again. it's either a UFO. And I guess that would be if you saw the holy Jerusalem coming down from heaven, from God. Now, it just gets described later in the chapter as being 12,000 stadia in every direction. So it's cubical. And 12,000 stadia is about 1,400 miles. That's a big city. So 1,400. Now, are we to take that? You know, this is a city that. My mom believes that. She told me that years ago. It's going to be, you know, a cubicle city that's 1,400 miles in each direction. I have a little trouble with that. That doesn't make sense to me, and I don't think that's what it means. So, for instance, you know, let me get into my diatribe here. So the book of Revelation is full of significant numbers, like 666 and 144,000. And what do you do with those? Are they meant for us to be taken literally or metaphorically? And so this is where you might have an argument with me. But so, for instance, the Jehovah's Witnesses, now this is what they used to believe, I'm pretty sure it's the same today, believe that 144,000 would make it to heaven. So they were the first Jehovah's Witnesses to get in the door. But they actually got past that number, so then they had to figure out, what are we going to do? We got new members coming in. So they grabbed onto this, there's a new heavens and a new earth. Ah, well, we'll put the 144,000 in heaven because they're the higher first ones. And then the rest will go on the new earth, right? So then you got lots of room. So they're taking this from the book of Revelation where it talks about 144,000, you know, of the redeemed are up on Mount Zion. But it also says there's 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, they're not taking that literally, but they're taking the number literally. Where do you draw the line? So, in fact, 144 is actually 12 times 12. So 12 is a significant number in the book of Revelation because there's 12 tribes of Israel from the Old Testament and 12 apostles in the New Testament. So they depict the people of God and kind of perfect it, 12 times 12. And 1,000 is 10 times 10 times 10. So this cube thing is a symbol of, once again, perfection, of completeness, of wholeness. And that's what I believe it means here. And another little point of interest is that when in the Old Testament, when you find the descriptions of how they built, well, I don't know if they built, they put together the tabernacle and they built the temple, Solomon built the temple, the very core of it, the Holy of Holies, the central, most central part of that, each of those dwellings, places, was cubical. It's interesting. The text makes pains to tell. I think it's 20 cubits each way. 20 cubits is like, what, 30 feet? 30 feet each way. And it was meant to symbolize the perfection. So this is where God would be with his people Israel. So they've brought that, well, tons of the imagery from the Old Testament is brought to the book of Revelation. And so hence this city is actually echoes and brings us back to that idea of the Holy of Holies. So the coming down to heaven from earth. Okay, are you all bewildered now? I am bewildered. These are just possible interpretations, help along the way, hopefully. But he says, as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. He changes the metaphor all up. It's a city coming down from heaven, just like a bride. Who hasn't seen a city that was just like a bride, right? So obviously metaphorical, but an important metaphor all through Scripture. So let's just remind ourselves about the beauty of brides. This is an Israeli bride in Jerusalem. She's got married, and she's kissing the wailing wall because that's a thing they do. And, you know, for a blessing, the wailing wall is the remains of the ancient Herod's ancient temple in Jerusalem. It's the last bit that wasn't torn down. This is a Maasai bride from Africa with the beautiful adornments, colorful dressings that they wear. This is an Apache bride from the southwestern U.S. Lovely. And this is a Chinese bride. And apparently in China, the tendency is, whereas here brides tend to wear white, in China they tend to wear red as wedding gowns. And as I've pointed out before, that's why they call it Red China. Well, you got it this time. Yeah, no, that's wrong. We probably identify a bit more with this because this is more of typical. I mean, it's a bit Scottish, but it's more Western, and you know, the bride in white coming down the aisle and everybody sitting in their pews. So, what is it about this? I mean, the marriage. It's a mixed bag for us. Marriages, you know, they don't all work out that well, and, you know, It's not a perfect metaphor by any stretch of the imagination, but it's one that the scripture keeps bringing us back to. It's in the Old Testament, it's in the New, in Ephesians 5, Paul specifically says, you know, that we, the church, are the bride of Christ. And he will present us to himself without blemish or spot or blemish or anything, any such thing. We'll be holy and perfected. So this continues with that view in the book of Revelation. So, but the idea of it is, the ideal, of course, of the marriage is that this is a place where there's deep intimacy and deep companionship and just the best of relationships. And so that's what's being depicted as the New Jerusalem, which is God's people being with God. I'm going to flip a page here. Fingers don't work on Sundays. They're dry. Oh, and that says, so then it says this, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Amazing. Now, notice, we tend to have got from someplace the idea that we're going to go off and be with God. We're going off to heaven to be with God. But the emphasis in this passage is God's going to come and be with us. Interesting. I mean, it's like three times. God's dwelling place is now among the people. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He'll be their God. So that's how humble, again, God is. He's not really expecting us to come to him as he is coming to us. That's an interesting description. And again, it's more about the intimacy. God wants us to be with him forever and forever. Don't know what, you know, what's it going to be like, this new Jerusalem, this new heavens and new earth? Are we going to be sitting on a cloud playing a harp? I mean, that's good for like, I don't know, a million years. But forever, we'd have to add in trumpets and keyboards and stuff like that, right? To make it, you know, what will it be like? I can only imagine, but I think there'll be stuff for us to do because we're human and God's going to complete us. So, I mean, that's part of who we are. We like to do things. We like to build things. We like to create things. We like to serve. We need to serve. We need to connect with each other. So I think there'll be ways that we do those kinds of things forever and forever in ever-unfolding wonderment. So, just my idea. I threw this up. Again, it's the depiction of Jesus on the road to Emmaus with those disciples who didn't know who they were with, but their hearts burned within them as they had this intimate conversation with Jesus. Walking with Jesus. And to me, that just depicted something of what's being talked about here, the intimacy, the connection with God that is complete. In this case, they didn't recognize who he was. And another depiction, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Now, I don't think there's anything metaphorical about this whatsoever. This is a direct statement of the promise of God for what you can expect. The things that are tough and difficult and sorrowful in this world will be over with. So I'm depicting those things a little bit here. So, death. And it's not really funny, but that's the last bit of semi-humor. No, we're done with death? Sorrow? No. All done. Crying, tears, no, all done, no more. Pain, suffering, lots of it around now, will be done, be all gone. He says, behold, I am making all things new. So that's God's plan. And we are to be joyfully expecting that and talking about that and telling people about that. Now, a few years ago, I read this book, and some of you have also read it now, Surprised by Hope by N.T. Wright. Tom Wright, they call him. He's a New Testament scholar out of St. Andrews University in Scotland, where Ben and Janice's son-in-law used to work and would bump into Tom in the hall. But for many reasons, they didn't form a close relationship. That's a long story. Anyway, he's quite a brilliant writer. This is called Rethinking Heaven, the Resurrection, and the Mission of the Church. Rethinking Heaven, the Resurrection, and the Mission of the Church. So it's right on topic of what we're talking about today. And he got me thinking, and I appreciate that, talking a lot about, you know, the expectation of a real physical, corporeal new heavens and a new earth, which is what the scriptures clearly tell us and teach, but how that connects with the now and what that means for us in our mission today. So basically, there seems to be two extremes that the Christians fall into. And on the one hand, we over the centuries, we've tended to say, oh, we're going to heaven. So we don't really care about this world. I mean, it's got pollution and it's got inequality and injustice, but that's, you know, so what? That'll all be done with and, you know, we'll be in a better place and anybody that wants to can come. So forget about this world. You know, seems kind of cold and callous, but that's been a bit of the perspective that many Christians have had. And on the other hand, we have this perspective that, we have to perfect the world. We're going to make a utopia in this world. And sometimes that gets us into a lot of trouble, like the communist experiment, which was supposed to make for utopia and made for hell on earth to some degree. So, so where are we? The truth has got to be somewhere in the middle here. So Tom Wright, he kind of jumps on this verse, and again, back in 1 Corinthians 15. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. This is at the end of the chapter about the resurrection. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And he really holds to that, saying, so if your labor is not in vain, that means there's something about what we do in this world that carries over, that has eternal meaning. And how that works, not sure. But there's another passage right from Revelation, which I often read at a graveside. And blessed are those who die in the Lord henceforth. Blessed indeed, says the Spirit, that their deeds, that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them. Same kind of thing. We will rest from our labors, but our deeds will follow us. So to me, there's a connection between what we do in this world and what gets carried over into the next world. And so Tom Wright, he's got three categories of that. There's probably more: justice, beauty, and evangelism. And I think there are others. But he sees these particularly as things that carry over, the effect of them carries over into the world to come. So just briefly, justice, for instance, poverty. Our world is full of huge inequalities and unfairness. And Christians have rightly been involved with helping people who are poor down through the ages, and we should be. And that's helping to bring justice, and that can carry over. Tom Wright is very big into trying to get people to erase the debts that the two-thirds world, most of them have huge debts to the more wealthy nations that they can really never, just paying back the interest, barely all they can do. Can never pay this debt back. Forgiving the debt, just a question of justice. Beauty. You know, we reflect God in making things that are beautiful, even in procreating. And artistic endeavors of all kinds. Now, this is so small, you guys can't see it. You can probably see it better online, you guys. But let's see. This beautiful depiction, you can see some landscaping. There's some color here. There's a river at the back. There's a building here. This is Hiroshima. It's a depiction of Hiroshima. So it evokes the horror of humanity's inhumanity to one another. At the same time, in the midst of landscape and beauty and hope for the future. So, you know, this is something that humans create, this kind of art. And is there not something about this beauty that carries forward? And of course, music. We know that that's going to go. Anything that we make that's beautiful here has to go into heaven, right? Yeah, absolutely. I'm not sure how that works, but, you know, it's music reflects and prepares us somehow for heaven. And evangelism, well, you may not think of yourself as an evangelist, but if you've experienced Jesus Christ and his forgiveness and his grace and his mercy and reconciliation and healing of your soul and, hope and joy and peace, supernatural peace, then it's hard to keep shut up about it. So there's a way it just spills out of our lives and our mouths to the world around us, like in our conversations. And, you know, our conversations are important with our neighbors and our friends. Then the first thing about those conversations is always to be listening to the other guys, to people from different perspectives and different worldviews, and showing them deep respect and letting them know that you understand where they're coming from. And when you do that in love, that gives you, that earns you the right to be heard. And really, you know, I've always thought, oh, I got to tell people what's what. But I've learned, or am learning, that that's not the way it works. So, but when we listen carefully, then we get a chance to start telling people, talking to people, what's going on in our lives and what God has done for us. These three ladies are texting. Do you know who they're texting? Each other. No, I just put that up there as a, you know, that's a way that we're spreading the good news of Christ is through technology, for instance, like through this camera and this outfit today, and all kinds of social media. I mean, it's happening in our world. It's a way a lot of people are hearing the good news of Christ. Alpha. That says Alpha, if you can see it. And even in church, people go to church sometimes. And surprise, you know, they hear about Jesus and they hear about God's plan and his love and his acceptance. So there's just some thoughts I thought I'd, you know, just to tie what we do in the everyday now to what we are to expect when God brings in his new heavens and his new earth. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your resurrection. We thank you that in your resurrection, there's a promise of a whole new heavens and a whole new earth in which righteousness dwells. Lord, and you call us into it, to your heavenly Jerusalem, the holy city. Lord, may we become more and more the citizens of that new land in this day, in this time. Lord, as we experience transformed lives, where we live justly, humbly, and wondrously in praise of you. Lord, we pray all of this in your name, Jesus our Lord. You who taught us in prayer to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 7:10 in Voices United. We're going to sing. So this song, Shall We Gather at the River, was written by, I forget, Robert Lowry, I think. And he wrote this because he kept hearing these songs about the river, but it was always like the Jordan River, crossing the Jordan, like dying. He thought, well, there's a whole story about the river that flows by the throne of God in heaven, the crystal river, the river of life. And why don't we sing about that and gathering around that? So that's where this came from.
Soon we'll reach the
shining river. Soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us, both now and always. Amen.
Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus.